Good morning, and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Urbana-Champaign. My name is Reverend Sally Fritchie, and I'm the associate minister of this congregation. I'm so glad to be here with you this morning, streaming live from our sanctuary on Green Street this morning. Our congregation's mission is to build community, seek inspiration, promote justice, and find peace. We are a church of many theologies that values deeds above creeds. A church that strives to build beloved community in the here and now. You may be joining us today from across the world or from just down the street. Wherever you are, please know that this community, this service is here for you in whatever form you find us. If you want to follow along with a written order of service, you can find that link just below this video on our website. And if you want to chat with your fellow UUCUC members, you can find the live stream chat box on our YouTube page. Remember that because we are live, there's still time to make your own contributions to our shared joys and sorrows later in the service. To do that, just email your message to joysandsorrows@uucuc.org. This congregation chooses to begin every Sunday with a formal acknowledgement of the indigenous nations of this land. It's a practice that connects us to the history of this place and our own responsibilities as stewards and members of a wider community. Wherever you're listening from today, please bring to mind the indigenous peoples and histories of your place. There will be a moment of silence after the acknowledgement. We recognize and acknowledge that we gather today on Indigenous land, taken through deception, coercion, and violence. We acknowledge the continued displacement and oppression of Indigenous communities and lift up Native commitments to survival, identity, and the protection of this world. Thank you. We gather today and every Sunday to remind ourselves of what is most true, of the deep humanity we hold in common and the interdependence that connects and sustains us all. It can be, I know, profoundly exhausting for a community, a nation, a world to carry the weight of so many concurrent crises and world events. Especially when we remain in so many ways isolated and distanced from one another. Yet each Sunday, we pause our mad dash and take a collective breath. We find our way here, connected across vast distances, and we refill our spiritual cups together. If you have a chalice or a candle to light at home, I invite you to light it now, as a symbol of our continued togetherness, despite our many different locations. We will light our chalice today with these words adapted from UU Minister Reverend Erica Hewitt. She writes, "To be a Unitarian Universalist means we'll never be done with the work of telling the truth about oppression, the work of stubbornly seeking out the spark of the divine in each other, the work of creating heaven on earth. To be a Unitarian Universalist also means we are not alone in the work. We are not alone because of our promises to love one another, our promise to be companions on the journey. We grow ourselves into allies, helping one another get free. We kindle the fire of commitment in the cup of sharing. May its warmth and clarity lead the way."
Thank you. tranquil streams that meet and merge and flow as one to seek the sea. Our kindred hearts and minds unite to build a church that shall be free. Free from the bonds that bind the mind to narrow thought and lifeless creed. Free from a social code that fails to serve the cause of human need. A freedom that reveres the past but trusts the dawning future more, and leads the soul in search of truth, adventure boldly unexplored. Prophetic church, the future waits your liberating ministry. Go forward in the power of love, proclaim the truth that makes us free.
Okay, everyone, it's pop quiz time. Who can tell me what the seven principles of Unitarian Universalism are? Without grabbing your phone and doing a quick Google. We all know that our congregation includes people from all kinds of religious backgrounds who have all kinds of different beliefs about life and death, good and evil, God and humanity, and everything else. But we also know that Unitarian Universalism is more than just a fun social club for real chill folks. We make promises to each other, and we try to make a positive difference in the world around us. And those promises and aspirations are articulated in our seven principles. In fact, this congregation is getting ready to vote on the addition of an eighth principle, one that focuses specifically on racial justice and authentic multicultural growth. So we figured before we start that conversation in earnest, we'd better brush up on the seven principles we already have. Kids who grew up UU might remember using the seven colors of the rainbow as a tool for learning about the principles, but plenty of UUs can get as far as 1, the inherent worth and dignity of people, 2, something, 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 3, the interdependent web of life, that's 7. There's actually an adult ed group right now in our congregation learning about the principles, so probably plenty of you could ace this pop quiz. But for anyone who might need a reminder, here are some UUCUC members to help us out.
UUs affirm and promote the inherent worth and dignity of all people.
UUs affirm and promote justice, equity, and compassion in human relationships.
UUs affirm acceptance of one another
and encouragement to spiritual growth in our congregations.
We UUs affirm and promote
the free and responsible search for
truth and meaning.
Still searching.
The right of conscience and the use of democratic process within our congregation and in society at large.
UUs affirm and promote the goal of world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all.
UUs affirm and promote respect for the interdependent web of all existence, of which we are a part.
Each Sunday here at UUCUC, we make space to share the joys and sorrows closest to our hearts. What joys and sorrows do you carry into our time together today? Let them rise to the surface of your mind now, and if you wish me to share them aloud, there's still some time to send them in to joysandsorrows@uucuc.org. Together, we're going to hear our blessing song, Long Time Sun, and then I will share aloud the joys and sorrows of this community. Healing prayers for the Pearson family, whose 13-year-old daughter, Layla, was struck by a vehicle while crossing the street this past week. Layla is alive and recovering from her injuries at home, and she and her parents welcome your healing thoughts and well wishes. A spring joy from Ellen Jacobson. We walked at Allerton yesterday and saw the most beautiful forest floor of flowers and all shades of green. What a gorgeous weekend. A joy from Mick McEnroe. This past Monday, I got dressed up and went before a judge to request my legal name change. I am now officially Mick Henry McEnroe. A sorrow from Susan Pierce. Healing prayers for all the long-haul COVID survivors who are still struggling to find their way back to health. A joy from Jerry and Tim. It was a joyous occasion yesterday to be with other UUs as we spread mulch, weeded, cut back overgrown shrubs, tended the butterfly garden, and many more tasks at the gardening work party. Thanks to everyone who participated. Their joy is echoed by Mike and Karen Retzer, who write, appreciation for being together yesterday in person to do yard work at church. Thank you to those who organized. Finally, a sorrow for the people of India and South Asia, who are facing a surge in COVID deaths and shortages of medical supplies. May their cries for help be heard and answered. Thank you all for sharing today. And know that the joys and sorrows that have gone unshared are still held in love by this community. I invite you to take a breath, take your hands off the keyboard or put down your phone, and help me hold these joys and sorrows with the tenderness and affection they deserve. We hold them in gratitude for time together, gratitude for spring and sunshine and forest floors full of flowers. And we hold them in hope for healing for everyone who needs most to be healed. Hope for resilience to get through these difficult days. We ask that the love of this community stretch between us and beyond us to embrace the whole world and allow us to find in that web whatever it is we need most today. I invite you to join me now in a time of prayer or meditation, after which we will come back together to hear about one more principle, the eighth principle, which might be added to our seven.
What is the eighth principle? Well, you know our seven principles, right? They're things that matter to us. Things that guide how we are as a community, how we treat each other, and what we want to bring more of into the world. Just like each of us is always learning and growing, we know our principles have to grow sometimes, too. This is the story of the eighth principle. A few years ago, some UU leaders spoke up. They told us these principles we love, they left something out. Like many who'd come before them, they spoke about how people still aren't being treated fairly because of the color of their skin, or where they come from, or other things that make them who they are. And that happens not only in the world at large, but even in our congregations, even in this one. So we need to do more to make sure that all people can feel welcome and loved here. We need to say more about our commitments to fight against racism, because racism hurts everybody. In fact, it hurts all seven of our principles. And so, the eighth principle was born. The eighth principle is a commitment to fight against racism and oppression, and to build a beloved community of love and trust and belonging here in our church, and in the world around us. We're going to be talking about the Eighth Principle a lot this spring, learning about it and what it means for this community. What does the Eighth Principle mean to you?
We, the member congregations of the Unitarian Universalist Association, covenant to affirm and promote
journeying toward spiritual wholeness by working to build a diverse, multicultural, beloved community.
By our actions that accountably dismantle racism and other oppressions.
In ourselves and in our institutions.
We as Unitarian Universalists acknowledge that our circle of care doesn't stop at these four walls. We are deeply connected to the community we find ourselves in and to the wider world. Even as we keep our safe distance, there are countless ways we can find to connect with each other. You're invited to our fellowship hour on Zoom immediately after the service today, where you can catch up with all your church friends, meet new ones, and talk about what you have planned for the week. Know that you are welcome in our support groups, religious education classes, and justice causes. Just keep an eye on our weekly e-news email newsletter for invitations to participate. Each Sunday, in recognition of our very real interdependence and reliance on one another, we pass the plate and share our offering with an organization doing the work of justice in the world. During the month of May, half of our collection will go to the Equal Justice Initiative, a nonprofit originally founded by lawyer and author Brian Stevenson, committed to ending mass incarceration and unjust punishment in the United States. Here is a brief video introducing the Equal Justice Initiative and explaining some of their work.
In the late 90s, we started challenging the way poor people are not provided adequate legal assistance.
Our criminal justice system treats you better if you're rich and guilty than if you're poor and innocent. Wealth, not culpability, shapes outcomes.
And we think that we have to change that.
I was convicted in 2000 for drug trafficking, which was a crime that I didn't commit. They sentenced me life without parole. I got in touch with EJI. They said, we're going to work for you, and we're going to get you out of here. And I cried. I just cried because it was just overwhelming to know that somebody was actually there to help me. August the 17th of 2006, I was released, and it just was so surreal. It was just so surreal.
The young girl who was 14 years old wrote to us and said, I've been sentenced to life without parole. Can you help me? And that was the beginning of our project challenging life without parole as an unconstitutional sentence for children.
The United States is the only country in the world that condemns children to die in prison, some as young as 13 years of age.
We've seen real progress. 8 years ago, we were executing children in the United States. And in 2005, the U.S. Supreme Court banned the execution of children. In 2010, we were able to persuade the court to ban life imprisonment without parole for children convicted of non-homicides. And now the court has banned these mandatory death in prison sentences for all children. We started a project on race and poverty, where we're looking at the legacy of racial inequality and injustice in America. We partner with schools, other advocacy groups and organizations who are all interested in education around these issues of race and poverty.
We try to organize people to act on the injustice, speak out on these issues, and raise awareness.
It's too easy to say that something is complicated, it's difficult, it's been that way forever, and tolerate it. We can create a more just society, but it doesn't happen by itself. It is not inevitable.
For me to be sitting here, it's a miracle. I get up every day, and whatever I look at, I'm not looking at it through a chain link fence. And you can't explain that to someone.
You can give by text or through the online portal on our website. Half of your donation today will go toward the work of this congregation. Half will go to the Equal Justice Initiative. We invite you to give whatever is generous for you, and know that anything you give will be gratefully received and put to use helping make a real impact in the world. The offering will now be taken. Some religious traditions are proudly defined by their ancient and unchanging foundations. Whether it's a leader's lineage traced back for generations, or a set of beliefs written in stone thousands of years ago, or scriptures still revered word for word in the original language. Yes, some religions strive to remain unchanged and unchangeable now and forever. Unitarian Universalism is not one of those religions. Not that we don't have deep historical roots, we do. But we are a tradition defined by change. We call ourselves a living tradition. If we were in the sanctuary together right now, I would have you look down at our hymnal covers to read the title, Singing the Living Tradition, to illustrate my point. A living tradition, like a living document, is one that is still accepting edits. Being a living tradition means we continue to grow and morph and change. We believe that divine inspiration can come from nearly anywhere, not limited to one particular type of person, one particular culture, or one long ago time period. When we're at our best, we recognize the value of new voices, new thoughts. This congregation, like many UU congregations, is considering changes to our central principles, the statements that we use to try to articulate our common promises and aspirations. And I can't lie, it's a little unsettling to think about such a change. Maybe especially for folks like me who grew up a whole lifetime within UUism, for whom the seven principles are just part of the way it's always been. Which is why I wanted to take a moment this morning to remind myself, to remind all of us, that there's no such thing as the way it's always been when it comes to our tradition. In fact, this month marks the 60th anniversary of the Unitarians and Universalists officially merging into one UU association. So, happy anniversary to us. On the one hand, 60 years is enough time for there to be third generation lifelong UUs, kids whose parents' parents never knew an uncombined version of our faith. On the other hand, 60 years is recent enough that plenty of you listening might have been around to see it. Our seven principles, all the way from the inherent worth and dignity of every person down to the interdependent web of life, were not delivered to us on a mountaintop generations ago. They were not inscribed on golden plates or written down by a prophet of God. No, these seven statements come to us from just a few decades ago, and their arrival involved the all-too-human process of drafting, redrafting, arguing, voting, feminist protest, more arguing, more voting, a few near schisms, and finally the adoption of the seven principles we have today. So sit back and let me tell you the tale of how the seven UU principles came to be. Once upon a time, the Unitarians and the Universalists were two separate denominations of liberal Protestant Christianity. They were each named for the heresy they committed, the heresy that caused them to be rejected by the mainstream church. Unitarians believed Jesus was a human teacher rather than part of God, Unitarians rather than Trinitarians. The Universalists believed in universal salvation, that is, there is no hell, or if there is, no just God would condemn people to it. The two denominations had their differences, but around the middle of the 20th century, they found that they had more and more in common. In fact, in 1954, the youth organizations of the two groups actually merged into one national group called Liberal Religious Youth. Relevant to this congregation, that's also when the Universalist Church here on Green Street first merged with the Unitarian Channing Murray Foundation on campus. So thank you to the youth for leading the way. But our story really begins in the year 1960. Ancient history. Just over 60 years ago, leaders of the American Unitarian Association and the Universalist Church of America met to hammer out the details of what would eventually be the birth of a new denomination. There were arguments over finances and over annual meetings, but the real conflict came with what they called the principles and purposes. How would this new organization articulate its commonly held inspirations and goals? To quote a UU historian writing years later, "Flowers and flames are sufficiently nonspecific to permit us to accept them as appropriate symbols. It's tougher when it comes to words." The main factions in the argument were, one, the Christians, who wanted to make sure the principles mentioned Jesus and specifically a Christian heritage. Two, the theists, who wanted to mention God but leave Jesus and Christianity out of it. And three, the humanists, who would prefer that God didn't show up at all. The debate began at an evening meeting of over 600 delegates and continued into the night. One participant, writing years later, called the experience unbridled democracy in action, a Unitarian Council of Nicaea, a parliamentary alley fight. Another participant, Don Harrington, remembers throwing his hands up and finally going to bed around midnight with the debate still raging, only to have someone pound on his hotel room door at 1 a.m., a leader from one faction saying, Don, we have some better wording, and we think the theists will accept. He responded that that was all well and good, but the Christians would never go for it. He went back to bed. And 2 hours later, at 3 a.m., another knock at the door. This time, it was a leader from the Christian Unitarian faction saying, Don, we have some better wording, and the humanists are on board. Come back to the table. And indeed, the next day, the newly agreed-upon wording for the most contentious principle was voted in, and the merger could go forward. Now, you might have noticed, I've managed to avoid, so far, including the actual words of this highly contested statement of principles, because I didn't want to give away the best part of this story, which is this. For all the effort and care and wordsmithing that went into these principles, the painstakingly struck balance between the various factions within the newborn UU Association, the principles they approved aren't even the ones that we ended up with. The merger brought us 6 principles, which included language such as, we strive to honor the dignity of man, to encourage cooperation with men of goodwill in every land, to cherish and spread the universal truths taught by the great prophets and teachers of humanity, immemorially summarized in the Judeo-Christian heritage as love to God and love to man. These principles truly were an achievement, considering the passionate debate that created them, and they enabled us to come into being as a new faith community. However, you may remember I mentioned feminist protest as being one key ingredient in our 7 principles, and nearly 20 years after that merger, the feminist movement came to Unitarian Universalism in a big way. A grassroots movement within UUism called Women and Religion began demanding major changes in how our institutions dealt with gendered roles and power structures. And the language built into those 6 principles about the dignity of man and men of goodwill, the value of brotherhood, well, it was an obvious problem. In 1981, leaders of the Women and Religion movement proposed a gender-neutral version of the 6 principles, and it was voted down at General Assembly. But there was a successful vote to create a commission to come up with an even more comprehensive overhaul of the language, in the hopes of reflecting the ongoing changes that were happening within UU communities in the 80s. What followed was an incredible undertaking, involving interviews and studies and nationwide surveys of UU individuals and congregations, spanning 3 solid years as the commission reassessed what language could possibly capture the breadth and diversity of Unitarian Universalist values and beliefs. In the end, they separated the inspirations from the aspirations, creating a list of 5 sources describing the roots that inspire our beliefs and practices. That's direct experience, historical figures, world religions, Christian and Jewish scripture, and scientific humanism. This freed up the principles to focus on concepts more immediate and accessible to all. The commission proposed their newly written 7 principles and 5 sources in 1984. Remembering the parliamentary alley fight of 20 years prior, they braced for the worst. But instead, after a brief and enthusiastic discussion, the vote passed with near unanimity. A chorus of ayes, along with a great deal of whooping, cheering, and more than a few sighs of relief. So there you have it. The end. That's how we got the 7 principles we have today. Other than the addition of one more source for earth-centered and pagan traditions added in the 90s, our principles and sources have remained unchanged for more than 35 years. They've shaped our congregations, guided our direction as a national denomination, and helped raise an entire generation of UUs who, like me, have never known anything different. I still look at those who came before me and built this faith into what it is with a great deal of admiration, even reverence. But there's something comforting about knowing that they could be just as messy, as argumentative, as frustrating and frustrated as anyone else. There's something reassuring about knowing they stayed up till 3 a.m. finding the perfect words, only to have someone point out years later that those words were sexist and would have to be rewritten. Perhaps it's better to think of our seven principles not as a rainbow of colors, the way UU kids learn it. Because rainbows are naturally occurring. They descend beautiful and whole from the heavens. Our principles are more like a rainbow-hued patchwork quilt, crafted by human hands, passed down through the generations, pieced together from whatever they had on hand at the time. Seams torn out and restitched here and there, and most importantly, made with obvious care and love. Being a living tradition means taking our faith in our own hands and continuing the work of shaping it into something that will keep future generations warm. Trimming frayed edges, replacing faded fabric, and occasionally grabbing the seam ripper and doing a major overhaul. And we are blessed with the knowledge that such work has been done before, and we survived it. The quilt survived it. In fact, we know on some level that the work is exactly what makes us us. We are a religion defined by change, a living tradition. There's something our minister, Reverend Florence, likes to say about the principles, which is that they are descriptive, not prescriptive. You don't have to sign on the dotted line agreeing with them. You don't have to recite them every Sunday. But they do a pretty good job of describing what we're all about here. In the 1800s, New England Unitarian churches used to publish occasional statements of what is commonly believed among us, a tradition that I think indirectly informs the way that we use the seven principles now. We don't all agree about many things, but here are some things that are commonly believed among us. Believed among us that wasn't fully captured in the seven principles. In 2014, the Black Lives Matter movement was born in Ferguson, Missouri, and in the years since then, many UU congregations have found themselves expanding their understanding of racial justice and engaging in a new movement to end white supremacy culture in America. New energy in our congregations led to Black Lives Matter banners flying outside UU churches, organized sanctuary efforts for undocumented neighbors, and deeper introspection into how we can respectfully and non-appropriatively create multicultural community. Don't get me wrong, UUs had engaged en masse in anti-racism work before, including in the civil rights movement of the 1960s. But this time, a grassroots movement of Black UUs and other leaders of color inside our faith have emerged to speak out about a new direction we could all be moving in, a new organizing ideal, an eighth principle. Just like the women and religion movement, the eighth principle is not being proposed by the national denomination, the UUA, but by thinkers and activists on the ground. UUs of color who believe the time has come to lean into our desire to keep our living tradition alive and thriving. The eighth principle. We promote journeying toward spiritual wholeness by working to build a diverse, multicultural, beloved community, by our actions that accountably dismantle racism and other oppressions in ourselves and our institutions. This proposed principle, authored by Paula Cole Jones, includes nods to our UU history in the form of a previous anti-racism effort called Journeying Toward Wholeness, as well as nods to the civil rights movement, where the term beloved community comes from. Paula Cole Jones and the other Black UU leaders advocating for the eighth principle ask that UU congregations consider adopting it with the language as written, as it was carefully chosen for its deep meaning and specific resonances. though she also acknowledges that if the eighth principle ever makes its way to a national, denomination-wide vote, there will likely be further wordsmithing and compromises to make. Paula Cole Jones clearly knows her UU history and knows well the growing pains and backlash of living in a religion built upon constant change. This congregation will have its annual meeting at the beginning of June to vote on the budget, the bylaws, etc. And some of your fellow UUCUCers plan to advocate for the official adoption of the Eighth Principle. There will be plenty of time to discuss and learn about what that might mean for us, but in the meantime, I'm here to celebrate the fact that this is something that can be voted on at all. To celebrate the fact that we have the power to take our tradition in our own hands and shape it ourselves. Our beloved seven principles were once written and voted on by people just like us, doing their best, making corrections, growing, changing, and piecing something together that has given us the ability to continue that iterative process of change into a future they couldn't have imagined. May we continue to change, continue to grow, and may we together do the work of keeping our living tradition alive, today and always. Amen. At the top of this service, we heard the hymn, As Tranquil Streams, which was actually sung on the floor of the assembly where the final votes in favor of the Unitarian and Universalist merger were being counted 60 years ago, almost to the day. A great deal has changed for us since then, and a great deal will continue to change. Finding the right words that will last for generations might be harder than finding the symbolism in flames and flowers, but the words of this hymn seem to resonate just as powerfully now as they did 60 years ago. So let our closing words be a reprise from UU minister and composer Marion Franklin Ham. As tranquil streams that meet and merge and flow as one to seek the sea, our kindred hearts and minds unite to build a church that shall be free. A freedom that reveres the past, but trusts the dawning future more, and bids the soul in search of truth adventure boldly and explore. Amen. And when you go, go in peace. Thank you. We close our time together by extinguishing our chalice with these words from UU Minister Reverend Elizabeth Selly Jones. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.